out there that Shurian sees from Fredrickson. Shurian takes it.
That's amazing. You know, the difference between first and last place in that race was less than 0.2 seconds. That's about the same amount of time as it takes me to snap my fingers. But here's what I'm curious about. When there's so many bodies crossing the finish line all at once, how do they get an accurate timing for all the runners?
Well, racing used to be pretty simple. Athletes would just line up and race each other. And the first one to cross the finish line was the fastest. But then we invented this. The stopwatch. And it was the stopwatch that changed the face of racing. Because now it was no longer a question of just who won the race, but rather, what was their time?
Here they come, Yoshioka.
The stopwatch allowed world record times to be set and then broken in every event. But it also meant that now each racer had to be timed by an official waiting at the finish line. Now there's one big problem with the stopwatch. It relies on people to stop and start it. But the reaction time of a human is at best 0.1 seconds. So it takes at least 0.1 seconds for me to decide that the runner has crossed the line and to push the button. In other words, it's not that accurate. In longer races, this inaccuracy isn't as obvious because the runners are more spread out as they cross the finish line. But in a short sprint, a few 0.1 seconds can make a huge difference. For events like the Olympics, we developed more precise equipment. Equipment which relies on electronics rather than humans to make the decisions.
Now, of course, the Olympics only happen every 4 years, but you don't have to wait that long to see some sophisticated timing equipment. In fact, this local track meet is using a timing system similar to the ones used at the big international events. So, let's see how it works.
It all begins with the starter. Notice the wire hanging down from his gun. It connects the gun to the timer's bench down at the finish line. So when the gun fires, the official clock starts to run. Now when 0.1 seconds can be the difference between winning and losing, it's important that no one gets an unfair advantage, like leaving the blocks early.
Now here's something you'll only find at the big international track meets. These may look like regular starting blocks, but they're not. What makes them special is this little device right here. It's a sensor that monitors the pressure on the starting blocks. And if an athlete pushes off before the gun fires, then the sensor sends a signal to the starter indicating a false start. Now there's one other interesting feature about these blocks. A horn mounted behind each runner. A horn that's also connected to the starter's pistol. But why a horn?
Well, because it takes time for sound to travel, the runners in the lanes closest to the starter actually hear the sound of the gun a fraction of a second earlier than the runners in the farther lanes.
So to prevent any of the racers from having an unfair advantage, a horn is placed behind the blocks, which goes off at the same time that the gun's fired. So each racer hears the start of the race at exactly the same time.
Okay, so the gun goes off, we have a fair start, and the clock is running. But how do we get an accurate time for each sprinter as they cross the finish line?
Well, the answer is we take a picture. Not this kind, a very special picture.
Mounted high above the finish line is a high-resolution video camera. But this camera only records a very thin slice of the track, the finish line. As the racers cross the line, the camera records a picture, 1,000 times each second. At the end of each race, a computer quickly takes the slices and puts them together one after another. What you get is a picture of each racer as they cross the finish line. And each slice corresponds to a specific time from the start of the race. To determine each racer's time, the official moves a cursor over the body of each runner.
The computer then calculates the runner's time accurate to 1/100th of a second. Once all the runners have been analyzed, the computer produces a list of the times for each lane, and that's how we get an accurate time for each athlete. You'll find the same technology at the Olympics. The only difference is that the equipment here is a little more sophisticated and a little more expensive. Now, you've probably noticed a lot of sprinters doing this when they cross the finish line. Well, there's actually a good reason for that. You see, the winner of the race is not the first person to cross the line with their hand or their foot or even their head, for that matter. It's the first torso to cross the line that wins the race. So in a real close race, a lot of sprinters will drop their head at the very end to get their torso across the line as soon as possible. And that's also how a runner's time is calculated, from the point where his torso first crosses the finish line.
You done yakking? You ready to give me that race now or what, buddy?
Excuse me for a second while I teach Pete here a lesson about sprinting. You're on, partner. Let's go.